6 o'clock we'll make a start. So we'll make a start, that's okay. What I'd like us all to do is to stand for a minute while we want thinking from Chris Blake, Councillor Lewis. So, thank you for that. Item one is declarations of interest. If anyone has a declaration of interest, I think I've got to be discussing something as a personal interest as chairman of Wirral Golf Club Limited on the item with regards to the golf resort. So that's a personal interest. But if anyone else has any other interest? No? Okay, thank you. Minutes of the previous meeting. Are they a true and accurate record? Yes, Cathy.
Yes, through you, Chair. Number 25 forms from my High Court judgment. On the second page, it says that a member requested that a full summary of costs be presented to the Auditor and Risk Committee, Management Committee, in due course, once all expenditure had been confirmed. That was me, and I didn't need to work in due course. For the record, through you, Chair, I'd like that the question that I asked with regard to the 20 quarterly set of accounts in forecast of the judicial review be brought to the Auditor and Risk Committee on March 2020, please.
Yes, it isn't hard with regards to what said about author effects. It's all on video, isn't it? And your recollection aligns with mine, which also aligns with the video. So, if that's possible, can we make that alteration? Or can we bring it to the next meeting? Yeah? Okay, thank you. Any other items of accuracy or? No? In that case, can we agree those minutes? Yeah, with that amendment? Okay, thank you very much. Right, next item on the agenda is the transformation portfolio update, and someone's coming forward to talk to us about this. Where you go. You'll explain to everyone who you are and what you're doing everything. And then, if you'd like to take us through the report, that'd be great.
That'd be thank you, Chair. So my name is Ted Gaines, I'm the Head of Business Change and Programme Management. The report that I'm presenting for you this evening has been prepared as a response to the Chair's request to provide an update on the Council's transformation portfolio, which was initiated in March 2016. The paper talks through the initiation from March 2016 by the Chief Executive in response to increasing financial pressures. The portfolio will also inform part of the Council's response to a corporate peer challenge in autumn 2015. The approach adopted was set out in the Board to Cabinet on the 21st of March 16, which specified two elements to be delivered concurrently: the implementation of a new operating model for the organisation and a transformation programme to drive forward new models of service delivery. As the office was set up in 2016 to take this work forward, oversight was maintained by a Transformation Portfolio Board, which is chaired by the Cabinet Member Transformation Improvement at the time, which is former Councillor McLaughlin. The former Chief Executive appointed an Interim Director of Transformation to oversee mobilisation and delivery. Work was commissioned by CAPTA to set up capabilities required to the Transformation Office to deliver a that significant program of change. The portfolio was aligned to the 2016 NTFS, which set out savings assumptions against a number of themes. Under the delivering differently theme, a number of service change proposals were developed. These, along with the savings assumptions, are set out in the table at 3.6. Two strategic programmes were mandated to take forward these proposals, and they are set out in the table at 3.7. These were the Customer Experience Transformation Programme and the Asset Transformation Programme, and it also sets out the purpose and projects under those themes. 3.8 of the report only stresses the governance and funding arrangements. Draw attention to 3.11, which talks about Paul Sator's recruitment when he was appointed as the permanent director of transformation. Mr. Sator undertook an assessment of the original forecast savings assumptions and found that these had been unrealistic or over optimistic. 3.12 talks about the investment to transform and support children's services. The report goes on to discuss the transition's current arrangements. In January 2018, the Chief Executive made a further restructure. The Transformation Office was refocused as a Programme Management Office. And in May 2018, the Transformation Cabinet Portfolio Holder Role was discontinued following local elections. 3.16, the new Chief Executive acknowledges that service-led design with strong corporate oversight, governance and control is required, and the Corporate Programme Management Office model remains in development. It sets out the two bullet points and the purpose of that theme. 3.17 through to 3.21 sets out the new governance and programme management arrangements which have been developed. And finally, in respect of member engagement, the portfolio holders continue to be regularly briefed on proposals, and key decisions are planned into work programmes of scrutiny committees, but it's critical in the future to align governance of the change programme with the emerging committee system, and we're keen to see that done and ensure there's assurance of the Council's evolving strategic change portfolio. And there's your overview, Chair, and I can take any questions.
Okay. Thanks. It doesn't, well, actually it does, but it gives me no pleasure to say I told you so. But I do remember at the outset of this change programme, I pointed out that A, I thought savings of 40 million were optimistic, and B, that there should have been a more cross-party, for want of a better word, governance of the change programme. I don't criticise any particular individual in any case, but know what the projects and programmes are and how they're being delivered. And I would think this committee would want a reassurance that there is a proper project and programme assurance being put in place and receive regular updates to that effect. So as we know, the projects are delivering on cost, they're delivering on time, and they're delivering on quality, and that those programmes are being properly assured and the methodologies being used. But I know I asked for a report because it has been one of those things that's been floating around, and to me, it needed some certainty, some transparency around what it was that was being done or wasn't being done. So that's where I'm coming from to begin with. Phil, Tim, do you want to respond to those? And then I'll bring in Phil.
Yeah, I recognise those points, Chair. In terms of the future relationship between the investment and change and the assurance of governance and the political interface, we'd be keen to work with committees to understand how they want that information shared, what's the best way to bring that forward and present that to you from dashboards, governance and assurance oversight, programme organisation, SROs, etc. We'd be more than happy to do that.
Well, I should probably gather a briefing, Phil. I'm keen to try and work with you and help wherever I can, if requested. Sorry, Phil, you wanted to.
Thinking back probably a decade to when I was chair of council excellence and then chair of the sort of successor body to that, when officers who have been departed because they moved on to other careers or retired, used to come to that committee and explain what was doing. Particularly a very senior engineer who left the authority some years ago. He was a one-time charge of office, but I don't think he needed that officer. One of the problems has been a succession of cabinet members, so that when they've been fully briefed and know what's going on, former Councillor McLachlan was mentioned, I think, and subsequent to her looking at a particular area like libraries and leisure and things, I think two more cabinet members following that, and some holding reports came to committee saying the work was still going. Mind if I perhaps refer to Appendix 1?
Yes, of course.
On page 27 in the memory I've got, where some of the projects are described as live, most are closed, but some are live. So the growth company, we know we're waiting to see the business plan for the first year. We have some information on assets, because we know the growth company have an ambition, I think shared by the council, to redevelop a site in Bergen for offices, and therefore that might achieve a chunk of that. But particularly wanted to ask about the review of libraries, leisure and cultural services, simply because in 2009, members remember it was a very important issue to me. I gave evidence to the Chartists inquiry. I remember it well. A former president from Pensby, I think Pensby Airby was present, and a number of other members who were worried about the process. But since then, there's been some stability. But a few years ago, we were advised that the council was developing an alternative delivery model that's mentioned in this document, and that might have involved moving that. Councillor from Pensby, Mike Sullivan, is a main driver in this community, certainly, devoting his own personal time to supporting the library and volunteers. Some libraries were able to develop a good, large group of volunteers and friends as they sent them through. Some libraries haven't. So there's been a period of gradually developing volunteers in some rather than others. Now, we're told that the chief executive is not in favour of alternative delivery models particularly, or outsourcing particularly, but we are still left with trying to run library services in the locations we had some years ago, but now with a much reduced staffing and dependent on volunteers. So the important for us to know, because Gulf talk of it in libraries here, page 27, strategy developed and consultation completed. programme of individual wide proposals in development, it says. And for those of us who had a great interest in still having libraries, then it'd be important for us to know what these proposals in development actually are. And that will probably go to one of the new committees, but it would be helpful for us to know quite what's in mind, Chair.
Yeah, Tim?
Recognise that in terms of gold floor and libraries, that libraries, there are still questions outstanding as an answer. So, I can ask the Assistant Director of Communities to provide an update to this as well.
Yeah, you see, now, I don't know if Ian wants to begin in a second. The issue is this issue about transparency and oversight. Yeah. So there is clearly work going on somewhere. We've got a programme office that coordinates that work. We'll have project managers, we'll have SROs, we'll have a range of other things, we'll have meetings, risk management, what helps, you know, and so on. But it's clear that a lot of the members have no oversight of that at all. Yeah? And so things can be being done. And the key part, I'm sure you'll agree with this, Tim, stakeholder management in terms of a range of these projects and programmes and good communication, change management, involving people, talking them through and so on and so forth. That hasn't been happening, and I think from the individual, which I think, you know, Phil needs to receive that information along to Cllr, but we'll pick some of those issues up in terms of what are the projects, how are they going and all that sort of stuff, what are they delivering. In terms of, from that specific to the more generalised, the general way that the council has been running projects hasn't worked well. And if we keep doing the same thing, we are destined to get the same results. And that's always been my concern. As you mentioned, I think you were talking about Dave Green, weren't you, Phil? And Dave looked at the projects and programmes where we had a previous project and programme list of activities, and from 15 million, we reckon only 2 million was delivered. So we seem destined to make the same mistakes over and over again, and that's why if we had a programme closure report, and we had the lessons learned, and we had more transparency and a bit more rigour provided externally from the stakeholders here, then that might help to keep some of these projects and programmes on track. That has been my experience. Ian.
Thanks, Chair. I just wanted to really follow up on your comments on those of Councillor Gilchrist. I think if councillors or members of the public ever wanted to see why they wanted to do the cabinet systems because of this report, had you not asked for this report, how would the rest of us have known that the report that Councillor Gilchrist has referred to is still ongoing and where we're up to with it? In particular, if I could ask two of you to ask Tim, when we talk about the £567,000 budget on page 27 for the review of libraries. Does that include the money that's been spent already on the couple of reviews we've had of the library service that are still haven't seen the light of day, or where are we up to with that? Because the line in this report where it says the strategy is being developed and the consultation is being completed, and a programme of individual library proposals is in development, that's the first that many of us have heard of this. I'd be interested to know how that £567 has been spent or is being spent, and what is the next stage in terms of consultation or children on that programme, because that sentence is fairly bland and meaningless, which from bitter experience with this particular portfolio area raises some alarm bells. So if you could perhaps fill us in a bit more on that particular aspect of that item, please.
In terms of the £567,000, I need to go away and get the detail in terms of what that project budget has been spent on. In terms of the future proposals, or the development of future proposals for the library services, the Chief Executive is clear that he wants that to be co-designed and informed by stakeholders. In terms of the ideas that have been put forward, the communities can be forward to the committee to speak on and progress that as soon as possible.
Yes. Go.
into specific areas. I think my area of interest here would be the adult social care. And you say that all three of those are closed, and it's working and contributing towards the 14.4 billion savings. Again, I think I need more breakdown of that, because it's on track, it's going to make it close this. But again, you know, it says there's not going to be duplication but sitting on the scrutiny committee, because we know that there is. So I think it's just more fact that we need to cover this.
And again, Kate, this one, as is you, in terms of the transparency, the reporting, centralised reporting that we're getting around this, is it asks, generates more questions than answers in terms of what's the budget, what are the savings going to be, how are they going to be delivered, and when are they going to be delivered. So there's just sort of really just listing off a series of things. We did talk about this in brief, didn't we, about, you know, in terms of what are the benefits, what's been delivered, how's it been delivered. The end project reports, so each of these should have an end project report, so you should revisit to see if the benefits are actually delivered. From my personal experience, the idea that we have an integrated social care and health system in Wirral, I would suggest we don't have at the moment. We've got the low people that are co-located, but that's not the same as integrated. So, and yet, as Kate points out, this list is closed, done, we've all moved on, let's go get the new shiny thing. So, whereas we might not have actually embedded some of the change. Phil?
Thank you, Chair. If we just work back in time, without bringing it up to 40, we had several sets of consultants who did reports on library facilities. I think one was BWB. Probably several hundred thousand pounds was spent on these consultants. That work was done 2-3 years ago. And as I mentioned, there have been several portfolio holders in the Cabinet since. Where few weeks away from setting the council's budget, not least debating it, March, whatever it is. What's worrying me is, are there any, I should say, agreements that we don't know about that have been made by portfolio holders looking after leisure, culture and other services that will suddenly be revealed in the budget at the last minute with consequences that would trouble us?
I think the issue about revealed is unlikely. I mean, you might be able to dig down into it and find it, but I don't know whether these things tend to be revealed. We've got Cher here, so Cher will understand any assumptions that she's put into the budget around savings in these particular areas.
Thank you, Chair. To answer the question, the answer is no. There'll be nothing revealed. We haven't back.
Resources. project way and a change management way, because at some point some of these changes have to stick, because otherwise you don't get your benefits, and and change management is notoriously poor. We have to think about that as you go through the whole process. So, Tim, what do you think? Am I talking nonsense?
I think we recognise some of that in terms of your maturity level, in terms of programme projects within the organisation, that there's a great deal of work to do. There are pockets of some really good examples of programme project management. I would suggest colleagues in Transport and Highways are more advanced than potentially the areas of the business. In terms of change management, you'd be aware that there has been investment in change management. Clearly within the programme management office and within organisational development, because it is recognised that we do need that support to transition change into business as usual, where in the past we haven't had that capacity available.
Okay, does anyone? Yes, sorry, Gavin,
sure. Just the figures on the budget for each allocated area, where I think his first one is closed, was that full amount spent or was there anything left? And also everything that's live, is that to be spent by that end date or is the money that's carried over? So it's just sort of like understanding those figures on the overall spend and whether there is an underspend and where it would go and carry over and what capital we need.
So recognise in terms of the detail of the budget that it's not as given provide you the answer to the committee that has been given to already. So I'm happy to go away provide further detail in respect of each of those distinct projects as to where how they were funded, they're not all levy projects, some of them are flexible use capital receipts transformation funded, some are capital projects. So I'll provide that clarity to the committee and obviously in the future as we report clearly that information is required.
Okay. If we're so a couple of things to come out of this. The 40 million we're not going to see because that was all safe. So whatever went before the settlement. And this isn't a criticism of Anne, because Anne did her best and she did try to keep us informed, and she always told me we were going to make the savings whenever I asked, but nonetheless. I understand the pressure she was under. We now understand that 40 million has been put. That programme is not going to deliver those benefits. We now have a new programme, a portfolio of projects that aren't at the moment, because of the mechanism, they're all being run by different cabinet members. I don't think, from the questions that come up, we think that's necessarily the best way forward, and we need to prepare for the new committee system about how we're going to ensure transparency and clarity about what's being done at the very outset. So I'm sure the Policy and Resources Committee will receive business cases about what's being done on what. I would say to Mr. McCall, anyway, in the new structure, one of the things that PNR should receive are the business cases that are wrapped around these in terms of what's being intended. There needs to be, I would suggest, a degree of at what level things go to. So in terms of how big is the project before it goes. But I also think that this committee should receive, certainly on a quarterly basis, a full report around the assurance. Sure, I don't mean someone going in and saying, yeah, it's all being assured, but a full report on all the projects that are in place about whether they're on track for time, cost, and quality, and whether they're likely to deliver the benefits on time as suggested. And I think, again, I make no comment about any of these other than, as Ian said, if I hadn't asked for it, no one would know. Make no comment around what's being done thus far, but just looking forward. And I would think it's a good idea to have an end of programme report with lessons learned, because if you don't learn the lessons of the past, you're bound to repeat them in the future. And we've seen at least 55 Second?
It needs to be measured.
Of course, absolutely, fundamentally. Kathy?
I just want to say that it always seems to me that we request information to come to the audit and risk, when I ask for the one on the board and now.
Very good, thank you. In terms of this,
So tonight I'm going to be presenting the Enterprise Architecture Report, which has been created following a request from Chair for assurances around the integration of applications, and that they are not just standalone applications. So the Council uses 197 applications across the estate. Enterprise architecture generally consists of four architecture domains: technology, applications, data, and business architecture. The diagram in section 3.8 is a reference model at a high level of the enterprise architecture, which focuses on the applications and the data. So just taking you through that reference model. So the channel access references the devices that people use to access applications. Presentation layer details how people access the applications. The integration layer details the method by which the presentation layer and the application layer communicate. Just referencing the API gateway. The API gateway is an in-house developed solution that enables our developers to control the integration between the presentation layer and the application layer. And one of our design principles moving forward is that all applications have an open API to ensure that we can control that integration.
Do you want to just explain what that means?
So the API
from a customer's point of view.
Absolutely. So the application program interface, or the API, fundamentally is that you've got a web application or you've got a client application, and then you've got the back end application. So you're accessing, so you go to the internet and you access an application on the internet. Yeah. The API gateway is what controls that communication between the two. So that's what the API gateway does. A roadmap is being created around all of our applications. We will take a make, buy, or rationalise approach, and that will drive the value of all of our applications. 197 applications is a large amount of applications to have. So we're looking at how we can rationalise those down. The data layer references how our data is stored, and then the business intelligence references how the data integrates to support decision making. Section 3.35 to 3.39 is the governance around this. How do we ensure that moving forward all the applications integrate, and that nobody's going off and buying applications that don't meet the design principles? And then Appendix 1 details a list of all the applications in the estate, what application servers they are on, and what databases they communicate with. So that completes my overview of the report.
Okay, thanks, Pete. The reason I asked for this, people will remember from the last committee, was that we started off by being told that automatic would never happen again because we're going to get a good planning system, IT system. Then, when we were told about what the IT system was going to be, it was growing like a topsy. And actually, at the end of the day, it was going to deliver all sorts. And again, one of my concerns around that was, you know, I have seen lots of people develop IT solutions, but I haven't thought of how it plugs in to the architecture of the organisation. And the first key lesson was to find out, does the organisation have its own enterprise architecture, which start to say we should be able to shake out more value out of those contracts. We should be able to reorientate our IT estate in order to generate better service for customers, but also savings by putting a lot of this stuff in the cloud and whatever, where it's a lot cheaper to store. I suppose that's my question to you.
So, yes, absolutely. So the application roadmap that we're creating will take that absolute approach. So we'll look at whether we want to rationalise and where we're going to continue with those applications. Then we will look at how we drive value out of them from a contract perspective.
Thanks. Agenda item 13, page 151, where it lists the various servers and databases. Can you tell me why is that exempt?
Just to be fair, I asked for this, and the executive had some concerns as business in confidence and a range of other things as well that might be wrapped around something. So it was either we don't get any, or we get the list and it's done in confidence. I think that was fair, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes,
ma'am.
Just to play devil's advocate, on the list of all the various items that are listed on these five pages, there are no company names or costs. So I'm struggling as a non-techie IT person to understand why that is exempt.
From a security perspective, so to tell all of our server names out to the public domain will create a security risk.
You know, we were talking about how we.
So is that common law where you said the names?
Yes.
Various codes.
Yes.
But okay. Columns 2 and columns 3, presumably, are not security risks. Whereas the function, application, and description.
No.
So that would be a risk.
Yeah.